I was dreaming to come to America. I had a brother who came here a few years before we did, and after he settled in Nebraska, he wrote and asked if we wanted to come to America. My husband and I were young, still in our 20s, and we brought our two little girls with us. They were just 2 years old and 4 months old. We were dreaming about it. We had heard a lot about America, the cheap farmland on the Great Plains, and the freedom. Oh, the freedom. We boarded the ship with more than 1,000 others. So many people wanted to go to America. The doors were open to everybody. It was very, very crowded, and many were sick the whole time. The trip took us 2 weeks, but finally we got here. We came to Castle Garden in New York, where all of us were registered. The noise was deafening, and the food, it was no good, mostly stale bread. When we left Castle Garden, we were taken to the rail station and headed west to Nebraska. Nebraska. We had heard much about our new home, but what awaited us there?
When the Schultz family left their home to come to America, they left behind friends and relatives they knew they would never see again. They walked away from everything they had experienced. Much of their heritage, passed down through the generations, was left behind. Peter Schultz was born October 12, 1852, at Quatre-Pelleriche by Marne. To his parents, Peter and Elzeba Schultz. He grew up on his father's farm, and as a young man, served in the German military. The military training was strict and very severe, and he later warned his younger brother to get while the getting was good. Following his military service, he was a reserve infantry soldier. Peter had one brother and five sisters. They all came to America, except his twin sister, who died at the age of 7. Margaret Dickman was born August 29, 1855, at Kronprinzenkoog, east of Marne. She had three brothers and four sisters. Her siblings all came to Nebraska, except an infant sister and a brother who died in 1882 at the age of 28. Earlier generations of the Schultz family farmed on a small scale in the Marne area. The Dickman ancestors were part of the working class, and several were referred to as wharfsmen, someone who worked on the docks or the dikes in East Friesland, where the land was being reclaimed from the sea. The family lines of the Schultz and Dickman clans can be traced to the 1600s in the church records. Beyond that, the family history continues to the time of the Reformation and then to the Middle Ages in an area known as Dithmarschen. Dithmarschen is located in southwestern Schleswig-Holstein, Germany, and lies along the coast of the North Sea. It has an area roughly the size of Hall County, Nebraska, and it was here the family lived for generations. Over the centuries, much of the land has been rescued from the North Sea by constantly diking and reclaiming the land. As a result, much of the land is flat and marshy, and the soil is very fertile and ideal for farming. In the latter part of the Middle Ages and up to the Reformation, Dithmarschen constituted a type of peasant republic with a complex organization and a well-developed system of local self-government. The society developed no nobility, and for many centuries, no ruling class was imposed from the outside. The people were said to be peasants, but they lived like nobility. They raised grain and sold it to Hamburg, Bremen, and the Netherlands, and much of it was transported with their own ships. At that time, most of the commerce along the coast of northern Europe was under the control of the Hanseatic League. Dithmarschen was not part of the League, but traded with it. The Republic sent ambassadors to the Vatican and the court of the Holy Roman Emperor. Dithmarschen was prosperous, and it was said that even the pigs ate from silver-lined troughs. It was prosperous enough that the neighboring kingdoms began to eye it covetously. In the year 1500, the King of Denmark attempted to annex the Republic. However, the people of Dithmarschen were unwilling to have a ruler of any kind. At the start of the year 1500, the King of Denmark assembled an army and, aided by his brother, the Duke of Schleswig and Holstein, plus some Swedish and Norwegian soldiers, prepared to subdue the Dithmarschers. Leading the assault was the Black Guard, which was a group of mercenaries from many European countries and hungry for loot. The Black Guard alone numbered 4,000, and the total army comprised some 12,000 men. The Republic of Dithmarschen had a total population of only 35,000. In February, the invading army came from the east and invaded the Republic. The Dithmarschers set up a barricade at a village called Hemmingstead. The invading army had to travel on a narrow road with water-filled ditches on both sides. It was raining and sleeting, and there was a lot of fog. The Dithmarschers had assembled an army of about 7,000 men, almost one-fifth of the population of the Republic. They managed to disable the Danish cannon, and the Danish army got bogged down in the mud. The Dithmarschers opened gates in the dikes and flooded the marshy and boggy land where the Danes were trying to maneuver. The Danes were completely routed, and the Dithmarschers captured many horses, cannon, and other weapons, plus a considerable amount of cash. Dithmarschen continued as a free republic until 1559, when the area was once again invaded by a different Danish king. The area was subjugated and incorporated into the Duchy of Holstein. After that, the people were forced to pay taxes to the Danish king, and the men were required to serve in the military. The following generations continued to take great pride in their distinctive heritage. The tales of the former republic, when Dithmarschen was free, linger in the hearts and minds of its people yet today. Peter and Margaret Schultz made preparations to leave Dithmarschen early in 1881. What possessions they had were sold or given away, except for the few relics they were able to bring with them. At the end of February, they traveled to the port city of Hamburg, some 50 miles distant from Marne. There were 22 souls in their party, including Peter's first cousin, Johann Jacob Moore. All of the group were from the vicinity of Marne. On the 2nd of March, they boarded the steamship Herder, an immigrant ship of the Hamburg-America line. The ship left Hamburg and 3 days later arrived at Havre, France, where it took on coal for its engine boilers. From Havre, they began the 3,700-mile trip to New York, steaming at about 15 miles per hour.
The number of German immigrants arriving in New York is far greater than at the same time in any year since the Board of Immigration was established in 1847. Last year, the figures were 104,264, which were greater than for 7 years previous. The tables have not been made out so as to give the result in actual figures, but Secretary Jackson says that he has no doubt that the total immigration to this port this year will be 450,000. The largest number of any previous year was 327,000, that of 1880. What sort of immigrants are coming? The secretary was asked. Mostly families of farmers. At least 75% of them go directly to the western states. Then they know their destination in this country? Yes, most of them come on tickets that are forwarded to them by their friends in this country. They have their railroad tickets and know exactly what route to take. Have you any idea of the cause of the unprecedented immigration? Yes, cheap fares have much to do with it. The steamship fare, which has been up to $30, has been as low as $20, owing to competition. Then the railroads reduced their fares so that an immigrant could go to Chicago for $7. This led to the purchase of many tickets by Germans here to bring over their relatives and friends. The number of this kind of tickets is unprecedented. What do you think is the cause of this increased immigration? Good times here? Opportunity for employment here, as testified to by other immigrants who have settled? A desire to avoid military service at home? And cheap fares. The number of tickets bought here and sent to Germans abroad was never so great. It has been remarked that the immigrants have been of the thriving class, who come with a little capital and intend to take advantage of the cheap land of the West and to acquire their own homesteads. The impetus to immigration is ascribed mainly to the prosperous state of business in this country, which enables the Germans here to send for their relatives and friends. The Sun, New York, New York, March 26, 1881.
The immigrant party arrived at New York on March 16, 1881. And disembarked at the Castle Garden Immigration Station on the southern tip of Manhattan. Here they were registered, checked by a doctor for sickness, and then provided something to eat. After claiming their baggage, they headed to the railway station to begin the last leg of the journey west.
Castle Garden presented a scene yesterday that reminded one of the busy days last year. There were collected 1,800 immigrants of every size and age who had been landed in the course of the day. The Herder from Hamburg brought 1,125. The Bothnia from Liverpool, 185. Abyssinia from Liverpool, 182. Villa de Alger from Havre, 175. And the Victoria from London, 175. The noise was deafening. Until the immigrants had started for their destinations. There were gathered together representatives of a dozen European nations who talked incessantly. Their costumes were not so picturesque as they once were, but they were varied enough to interest the visitor. No sooner was a careful record made of each person with his or her trade or destination than the representatives of the different nationalities began to gather in groups in order to pass away the time before their departure east, west, north, and south. Suddenly, boxes were opened, and stale and unpalatable food was taken out. The Danes and Scandinavians were provided with more food than the others were. The Swedes were fine, hardy-looking men. A few of the women were good-looking, and nearly all were blondes of the fairest kind. The Tyrolese were easily distinguishable by their long, fancy stockings, knee breeches, embroidered waistcoats, short cloaks, and cone-shaped hats adorned with feathers, while their wives wore petticoats with bright stripes or trimmed with what looked like gold or silver lace. While the Italians were laughing noisily, the Irish were shouting, and the Swedes were kissing each other. New York Tribune, March 17th, 1881.
Statistics from Castle Garden indicate that before the end of the present season, at least 175,000 additional German immigrants will have distributed themselves over our territory, seeking homes in a new land. These new settlers will provide a valuable acquisition to our population. They are sturdy, industrious, and furnished with sufficient means to enable them to make their way in the home of their adoption. The greater portion come from the farming class and are especially desirable as settlers. Germany now contains a population of something over 45 million souls. The area of land occupied by the German Empire in Europe is becoming too small to comfortably support its population. The enforced military service and the disturbed political atmosphere, together with the greater inducements offered by this country to thrift and enterprise, are principally responsible for the exodus. Omaha Daily Bee, April 6, 1881. The indications point to an unusually large immigration from Europe to the United States this present year. It was heavy last year, and it will probably be heavier still this. Advices from Germany state that in some parts, entire villages are being depopulated by the immigration of their inhabitants. And although it is early in the season for immigrants to move, the Hamburg and Bremen steamers are already bringing over large numbers of steerage passengers. The proper places for them are the West and Southwest, where cheap lands offer them the means of an easy living. Our own state could absorb a considerable number of the newcomers, and it might be worthwhile for our immigration societies and railroad companies to devise a plan for securing them by means of an agency at New York. Omaha Daily Bee, March 30, 1881. Nebraska has utterly failed to realize the great importance of the mighty tide of immigration, which is pouring upon our shores hundreds of thousands of able-bodied men and women. Leaving their homes across the sea, they have come to aid in opening up and developing the resources of our states and territories, and to add to the material wealth of the whole nation. Political economists place $1,000 as the lowest money value of an immigrant to a new agricultural community. Statistics show that the average of property brought over by German families is $1,200. For more than 3 years, the Bee has urged upon Nebraskans the importance of using every effort to divert to our borders a portion of this mighty tide of wealth, which is beating on the eastern shores of the continent. Omaha Daily Bee, April 29, 1881. America welcomes gladly to her fertile lands, her busy factories, and her fields of labor this vast army of weary but ambitious foreigners. Here they will find land for the landless farmer and good wages for the skillful and industrious artisan. We have light taxes, an insignificant army, and a government of which they may soon become constituent parts. We have mines yet undiscovered, rich prairies unbroken by the plow, and vast industries now in their infancy. A thousand lines of endeavor lie open to them. What wonder is it that they come? Omaha Daily Bee, June 4, 1881.
The group of immigrants that left Marna at the end of February all headed west after leaving New York by railroad. Peter's cousin, Johann Jacob Moore, settled near Lincoln, Nebraska. Another group settled near Schuyler, Nebraska, and at least one went to Davenport, Iowa. Peter and Margaret Schultz and their daughters were bound for Hall County, Nebraska. Surely they were unprepared for what yet awaited them.
Unprecedented overflow of the Platte River prevented the arrival of trains from the west the past 2 days. The Missouri River is breaking up at Nebraska City. Damage and further railway interruption feared in nearly all quarters. But the blockade of trains in the east equalizes the affairs. Nebraska State Journal, March 13, 1881.
The Union Pacific Depot at noon today presented a rather confused appearance, and not one often witnessed there. The water had risen between North Bend and Fremont, so that further efforts to transfer passengers, mail, and baggage about the break are useless. And through trains over the main line of the Union Pacific are abandoned. Arrangements were made Tuesday to send trains from Omaha to Kearney by the B&M route and train number 7, the immigrant train, which was the first to take that road Tuesday. Train number 3 went that way yesterday. Number 4 will come in the same way, and all through trains for the present will follow suit. Everything now depends on the action of the Platte River, as the moving of the ice gorges may at any time raise the water blockade. Omaha Daily Bee, March 17, 1881.
The usual regularity of the Union Pacific passenger and mail trains was interfered with last week by the high waters caused by the overflow of the Platte River, about 3 miles west of Fremont, where the track has been underwater for several days. And it's believed portions of the track have been washed out. The company has been compelled at this point to transfer the passengers by teams, about 20 of which have been employed on the arrival of trains. Columbus Journal, March 23, 1881.
The whole Platte Valley from Columbus to Fremont is underwater. No such flood has ever occurred in the valley since the Union Pacific was built through it. The first flood at Columbus subsided late this afternoon sufficiently to show what damage had been done the Union Pacific. Three spans of the Pyle Bridge, which is an approach to the Iron Bridge of Loup River, were washed out, and the track is washed from 1 to 3 feet deep for a long distance east of the bridge and for about 3/4 of a mile west of the bridge. Another ice jam in the Loup River, larger than the first one, broke at Genoa this evening and will again swell the Platte tonight more than ever. A dispatch from Benton Station late this afternoon says dead cattle, hogs, also bridges, houses, wagons, and lumber were seen floating down the stream. Wyandotte, Kansas Republican, April 2, 1881.
After Peter and Margaret Schultz and their two young girls arrived in Grand Island, they headed south to the Doniphan area where Peter found his first employment. They had traveled 5,500 miles to their new home on the Great Plains. Margaret's brother, Gehrt Dickman, had settled near Doniphan a few years earlier, and the Schultz family first stayed with him. Gehrt Dickman was hired to herd cattle between the channels of the Platte River, and in 1883, he filed for his own homestead and expanded his cattle herd in that vicinity. In the early spring of 1882, Peter's parents and sister Amelia immigrated and came to Doniphan. In the summer of 1882, Peter and Margaret added a son to their family. The following February, Amelia married Gehrt Dickman, and they began their life together on their homestead, making settlement on May 1st. Gehrt and Amelia Dickman and the Schultz family were close neighbors to Fred and Margaretha Langmann in the Platte Bottom, and the Langmans would be a great influence in the future of the Schultz family. Fred Langmann came from Germany as a young man and was about the same age as Peter Schultz and Gehrt Dickman. By 1883, he had been living next to the Platte for several years and had a wife and three small children. The young Langmann family had become accustomed to the rampages of the river in the spring, but their worries in 1883 were well-founded. The snow and ice in the mountains and recent rains swelled the swift-moving water over the banks and into the Fred Langmann homestead. Fred was away at the family's Prairie Creek farm, which was northwest of Grand Island. Meanwhile, pools of water entered Margaretha's kitchen and engulfed the outbarns, damaging large quantities of hay and separating mother cows from their calves. Seeing the Langmann's hired man across the opposite bank, Margaretha quickly gathered her young children and placed them on the highest spot away from the river she could find. Turning back, she trudged to the river to a small boat and ferry, grabbing the attached rope to maneuver herself to the other side. Then, something broke. The boat bounced and capsized, tossing Margaretha into the plunging waters and sweeping her helpless body downstream.
A shatteringly tragic incident happened to the family of Mr. Fritz Langmann during the sudden high waters of the Platte River Tuesday morning. The wife of Mr. Langmann attempted to rescue one of her husband's servants, who, running to an island in the river, had attempted to rescue livestock that had escaped there. She entered a small boat to cross the river. When almost in the middle of the stream, the vessel capsized and buried the unfortunate woman under the floodwaters. Until yesterday, it was not possible to find the body of the victim. To the grieving relatives, we express our most heartfelt condolences. Der Herald, Grand Island, Nebraska, May 25, 1883.
It wasn't until 4 months later in September that someone found the skeleton of a human body on a sandbar near North Bend. On the third finger of the hand was a ring bearing the inscription, Fritz to Margareta. Bringing her remains back to Grand Island, Fred was able to inter her there and begin facing the reality of caring for his three motherless children. Margareta Langmann was 28 years old at the time of her death. Fred abandoned the Platte River homestead and moved his young family to Grand Island. The Prairie Creek farm northwest of Grand Island was rented out to Peter Schultz, the farm where Fred was working when his wife drowned in the Platte. Around March 1, 1884, the Schultz family moved from the Doniphan area to the farm in Center Township. A daughter, Marie, was born that summer, and another daughter, Margaret, was born there 2 years later. In 1887 or 1888, Peter and Margaret Schultz and their family of four daughters and one son left the Langmann place and rented another farm 5 miles further west in Section 33 of Mayfield Township. The neighborhood was known as the Berwick community, which at one time boasted of a church, school, and post office, as well as the cemetery. Alva Rickard sold the farm in 1892 to Peter Schultz for $25 an acre. The purchase included a sod house, outbuildings, trees, and a well. The three youngest Schultz children were born in this sod house. Around 1897, a new house was built for the family and an addition added to the east in 1906. The family put down roots in the area, and Peter and Margaret spent the rest of their lives farming and raising cattle. Margaret died in 1929, and the following spring, Peter sold his farm equipment at public auction. His son, William, and family moved to the home place in the spring of 1932. After Willie's death in 1974, his daughter Marjorie lived on the place. She died in 2016, and the farm passed to her sister's son, Leon VanWinkle, and his wife, Patricia.
This is the farmhouse that was built in 1896. The west half, which is about 400 square feet, has two main rooms downstairs, a bedroom area and a living area. Upstairs, two bedrooms. This particular part was the only part of the house until 1906 when John Coe built the addition, which is the kitchen area and the small porch area. All together, that made the particular property a little bit more than 600 square feet. At that particular time, the living conditions were, of course, no electricity, no plumbing, and like that type of deal. And that went on until 1949. And in 1949, electricity was brought to the property, and then there was no indoor plumbing or running water until 1966. At that particular time, we got hot and cold water, but still, up until this day, no indoor plumbing as far as the bathroom goes. Prior to this house, in the late 1880s and early 1890s, the whole context of the living conditions was the sod house, which was situated in this particular area. It lengthwise going north and south. It basically was 17 by 28, and it had an upstairs, which was just boards so that people could sleep and make it into their bedroom facility. It faced to the east. The big wood door faced to the east, and it had a window to the south and two windows to the west, and on the north was actually a porch area, which was approximately 6 foot by 12 foot, and that was kind of the entry area. This particular item was situated in this area until the early 1900s, when it got moved to a different location. When it was in this position, the open well was right in this area, which was the south end of the house. The hitching post, which was the main hookup to when people would come and visit, which is right, got moved over to this area now to use as a post. But this was the hitching area that from the 1890s all the way to the 1970s when we moved it to be part of the fence. This is the current structure that is still the same footprint of the original sod house. It has been boarded up, but it's still the exact structure from the early 1900s until today, 2018. We're using it for storage, and we have an area where we had our grain stored and some firewood stored and a few machinery items. And this particular unit's the same format, only change is the wood siding. On this particular north side is where the main entry was, besides the east entry. This is from the north. It was like an add-on porch type deal, and it was approximately 12 to 14 foot in length and about 6 foot in depth. And it became the entryway to put all your clothing as you went into the main house. That's since been disassembled, but it was still a part of the building, as I recalled as a child. This particular building was built in the 1920s. We always called it a summer kitchen. It was a summer kitchen because it was a way that the gals could line up the food for the thrashing crews that came through and keep all the heat out of the house, because the cook stoves made the house unbearable, especially in the 30s. This particular area is a 10 by 12 building. It had cabinetry in it, it had the cook stove in it, and it also was used in later years for the laundry area. When the thrashing crew would come through, they would have 16 to 20 people, and all the food was cooked here, and all the guys would lay out on the grass and eat, because it was too hot to go inside a building. This is what we call the first chicken house. We had enough chickens here that it would help towards the cause as far as the eggs. And this was the main building, which was their safety at night. As they went out during the day, it was a fenced-in area, so it was called the scratch and pen, and that particular area gave them a chance to get out to the real world when, if it was a nice day where we could watch the chickens, we would let them out, but we had to watch out that the turkey vultures would not attack them, or if it got too late in the day and a storm was coming, we had to make sure they got back in the building again. This is what we call the back chicken house. It just had extra chickens that, because you needed eggs and you needed chickens for food, and so it just added to our total situation. This was the main building. There was a covered area, which was been torn off now, but it was called the indoor scratching area. Still let the chickens get out, but not into to where they would get lost in the environment. This particular area here was the outdoor scratching pen area. And so between the main building and indoor scratching and outdoor, they was able to get through all the cold of the winter and the hot of the summer. Okay, on one thing while I'm out in this area is our, what we call the corn crib. It was one of the first buildings back to the days of the sod house. this particular building, three-quarters of it was lined up for ear corn, and which is the crib part of it. And then we had a granary in the other quarter part of it, which we'd have the wheat or whatever that was stored for next week's crop. And the barn set in this area here with the link east and west, 40 feet, the width 28 feet, and the height 40 feet. It had a hay mow in the top with a hay sling, and that had a cupola on it which announced the date 1907. 1907 was made by, it was made in 1907 by John Coe, who added to the house in 1906. In this barn, it was set up for 8-head horses. There was also an area for small calves, and there was an area for a granary for the oats for the horses, and then there was two areas for the milking option, or being milked in the corral if the weather permitted. As far as the hayloft goes, there was actually entries from the hayloft down to all the stalls, so everything could be fed from above as far as the hay. You didn't have to bring it down. It was just dropped to a chute, so every horse got its share. And then there was also little bunks that you would give the oats to the horses, and everything would be fed. Each day when the horses went to the field to help work, my grandfather ran 4 head of horses. At that particular time, every noon he would come in and made sure they got dried down and cooled down and got their feed so that he could go back to the farm again. The 4 horses, as I recall, in my early times, was Babe and Blue and Ned and Molly. And those 4 horses basically did all the work on the farm, and they lived out their life here, some of them living as long as 30 years. At this particular time, all the broke ground we have in the corn crops, we've had Milo in the past. Part of this area used to be alfalfa to help with the cattle and horses. We developed it so pretty much about 50 acres is in row crops, which is corn. The rest of the land is back to what I mentioned about pasture, 22 acres native prairie pasture. And then we also have a creek area, which is our wooded area, which is kind of the confines for our wildlife. And there's approximately 10 acres that is not in production. We had a tank here for the watering of the cattle, and as the water came from the windmill to the regular tank, it went through another tank inside the building, which was a cooling tank. And so we had the cooling tank inside, we had the milk separator inside, and that was a way that we could handle everything in one destination. The windmill originally set just beyond the milk house. It was 40 foot tall, and there never was a pump jack. It all had to be handled by hand, so if the wind didn't blow, you stood out there and you pumped on the pump. 40 feet tall, and whenever you had a problem, you had to climb all the way up to work on the wheel. The wildlife can get their drink. It also, there's areas in here where it's the buffalo wallows yet from the original, when the homesteaders came through in the 1870s, 1880s. This always lets you know that it's going to be a profitable year if you see water here. If you don't see water, you know the crops are going to not do well because it's all a dry land farm. Never has had any irrigation. And for many, many years, it was all fertilized by the cattle droppings. We have an old picture on when one of my great aunts got buried in 1897, and the whole family stood out in the pasture area, taking a shot of the long distance of the place. At that particular time, it was 1897, and you still see the corn crib, which is partially covered by the tree. This particular grave is my great-great-grandmother. She was not doing well, so she could not come out for the 1897 pitcher on the farm. But she was in the sod house at that particular time. And on the photo, you see the sod house, but you do not see her as part of the gathering at that particular deal, which was my great-aunt Emma's wedding. This is my great-grandfather, Peter, and great-grandmother, Margaret. Peter was the president of the cemetery board all through the years of the late 1800s, early 1900s, until his passing in 1932. At that particular time, my grandfather, William Schultz, took over as president of the board, and he was president of the board for 42 years until he passed in July 18th, 1974. So I've been coming up here and helping my grandfather, my mom, my aunt, and so basically since the mid-50s, I've been trying to help towards the improvement of the cemetery.
Let us run. Grandpa. Tell me about the good old days. Sometimes it feels like this world's gone crazy. Grandpa, take me back to yesterday, when the line between right and wrong didn't seem so hazy. Did lovers really fall in love to stay? Stand beside each other, come what may. Promise really something people kept, not just something they would say. Families really bow their heads to pray. Daddies really never go away. Oh, oh, Grandpa, tell me about the good old
days of just keeping time, of hanging around in sleepy towns forever. Back roads empty for miles. Well, you can't have a dream and cut it to fit. But when I saw you, I knew we'd go together like a wink and a smile. Leave your old jalopy by the railroad track. We'll get a hip double dip tip toppy two-seat Pontiac, so you can rev her up. Don't go slow, it's only green lights and all rides. Let's go together with a wink and a smile. Give me a wink and a smile. Never end. This is where I belong.